Jeremy, lovely. This is absolutely great.
Sir John Hegarty, an icon, a legend in the world of advertising, and of course, a great friend to us at Peace One Day. So thank you for all the support over the years. Can you tell me about your story and how you got to where you are today?
Well, absolute pleasure. I mean, the first thing about one's journey is get lucky, all right? So I was born in 1944, end of the war, coming out of it, opportunity, because I came from a very working class background, was there. So I was able to go to art school. And from art school, I went to design school. So I studied graphic design. And whilst I was studying graphic design at the London College of Printing, as it was then called, now called the London College of Communication, because obviously people don't do printing anymore, I was introduced to the world of advertising. And the way I approached my creativity, because we're all creative, that's one of the things that everybody needs to understand, but the way I loved ideas. I loved having a blank page and coming up with an idea. And I was sort of vaguely frustrated with design. I mean, I love design. I love, you know, the aesthetics of it and, you know, typefaces, typography and spacing and colour and shape and form, all those wonderful things. But I always used to be, when I was in design school, I'd say, so what's the idea? And people used to look at me in a kind of glazed expression. What does he mean, what's the idea? I'm just designing a brochure, or I'm designing something. Or I said, but you've got to have an idea. And it was whilst I was at the LCP that I was introduced to advertising and the great work coming out of New York at that time, and agencies like Dorden Burnback, who became legendary. And what they did is that the core of everything they did was an idea. And the idea was generally funny, witty, smart. It was engaging. It made you smile. But also, crucially, it was inclusive. And that's the brilliant thing about advertising, is that it wants to include, but by definition, because you're out there trying to get as many people as possible. So it's no good having ideas that sort of are very smart and exclude. So it was brilliant looking at this, and it was, for me, it was like a light bulb moment. The light switch went on in the darkened room. I thought, this is what I want to do. So whilst I was there at the LCP, I developed a portfolio of advertising ideas. And of course, at that time, saying you wanted to go into advertising was a bit like saying, you know, I want to go into partnership with Diablo, you know, ooh, the devil, you know. And but I thought it could be great, you know, it could be great if it's done well. It respected people and it kind of. So I got a job in advertising, and within a week of being in the industry, creative director at an agency, American agency, I'd got a job with at Benton & Bowles in Knightsbridge, no longer exists. Walked into my office and said, John, I've got a writer for you to work with. Now, I was an art director, so that was where I was coming from, as you work as writer and art director. That's an important kind of partnership, because you've got one person who thinks visually, the other person who thinks narratively, and this construction kind of adds tension, and that tension creates sparks. And so he walked in and he said to me, I've got this writer for you to work with, young writer starting out as you and I. So I said, what's his name? And he said, Charles Saatchi. And I went, oh God, oh no, he's Italian, lives at home with mum and can't spell. That's just my luck. And anyway, it so happens, I've told this story many times, but it so happens he wasn't Italian, but he did live at home with mum, and he wasn't very good at spelling. But he was a brilliant, brilliant copywriter and thinker. And that was my start in advertising, working with Charlie Saatchi. We developed a great friendship from that, and then eventually when he started his own agency, he asked me to join. So the year I came into advertising, now this is the other thing, I said to him, when I'm talking to students these days, I say, 1965, and you can see them looking at me going, that's the last century. I mean, how old is this man? And so I kind of sort of either say, you know, I came into advertising around about the time that Gutenberg invented movable type. And that kind of worked up until about the year 2000. And I was talking to some students, and I made that point again. I came in, you know, and I could see them looking at me going, who on earth is Gutenberg and what is movable type? You know, this is a digital age. And so then I had to kind of have a new line, which was, I came into advertising around about the time that, you know, water was free and we paid for music. And that kind of sort of worked for a bit. So I came in there, but the other thing is, it was just about the time that the Beatles were releasing Help, and that for me was pretty cool. So so that's when I came in, and it was a fascinating time to join the industry, because the whole kind of 60s revolution was developing. It came into advertising about 10 years later, because advertising was sort of controlled by large organizations, but the beginnings of it were there. And this revolution, and I think what's great about the 60s revolution, that if you look at it for the first time, it was from the ground up rather than the top down. So up to that point, you know, creative movements had been sort of in the control of quite wealthy people, because they were the ones who had the time to do it. They could, you know, they could sponsor this, sponsor that, they could get these things. The 60s really were the first time that it was a kind of working class movement. It started, you know, if you look at all the great work, you look at the great people, you look at, you know, the Rolling Stones, you look at the Beatles, you look at Bob Dylan, you look at all those people, you look at the playwrights, the artists, what was happening was coming from the ground up. And I think that really made it very, very exciting. And at a time when huge change was occurring, the sort of youth movement culture, the development of the teenager that came out of the sort of mid to late 40s was really growing because of wealth and disposable income. So I think it was a fabulous time to be in the creative industries. It was expanding. So I eventually joined Saatchi & Saatchi, and then worked with Charlie and his brother Morris. And then I left and became creative director of a European agency called TBWA. They were starting their London office. And I can always remember us talking about Europe as a concept. I could see people's eyes, this is like 1973, and I could see people's eyes glazing over. Europe? Well, I'm in Bolton. What's Europe got to do with me, kind of thing? But they sort of anticipated what was going to happen. And that was very successful. We built the London office of TBWA up. And then in 1982, with my two other partners who I'd met and we'd worked together at TBWA, we set up Bartle Bogle Hegarty. And it was kind of a great time to again to do it, because the beginning of the 80s, again, great change, big bang, all of those things were happening. Whether you like Margaret Thatcher or not, I was not an overall great fan, but opportunity was great. And we built BBH up into being a highly regarded agency with accounts like Audi and Levi's and, you know, Whitbread Beers that were then a brewing company. And, you know, lots of great business that became, you know, and the work became culturally important, especially for Levi's, Audi, you know, Vorsprung durch Technik, which we got the, we taught the English public to speak German very, very badly, because we pronounced it incorrectly on purpose, you know. And we'd get letters from German teachers here, you're pronouncing this completely incorrectly. We'd say, yeah, it's the part of the joke, you know, part of the joke. And so, we, you know, hugely successful company. And then I left that in 2014 and started the Garage Soho, which is why you see that on the wall. The Garage Soho is what we call an early stage investment company, and we help businesses get up off the ground and find them finance and guide them and help them with brand building, because that's where value will reside. And then 2 years ago, we then developed the business of creativity, helping businesses understand that they've got to engage in creativity. If they don't engage in creativity, they will actually lose opportunity. Innovation, all the things that creativity teaches you. So that's the new mission I'm on, teaching people that creativity is fundamentally important to their future, not only as a business, but actually as an individual.
Amazing.
So that's a kind of brief run through.
John, how important is constructive narrative that informs, inspires, and engages people towards action that's measurable, particularly in relation to humanity's survival?
I think You know, it's very interesting, actually. In the last 20 or 25 years, with the digital revolution that occurred and social media, we've kind of lost the art of storytelling because, you know, those who created social media have kind of convinced people that actually you don't really need that anymore. It's one-to-one communication. Just tell them what you're selling, you're doing, or whatever it means. So the art of storytelling has been sort of lost a little. And you might say, well, does that matter? Well, the point about it is that storytelling is absolutely fundamental to human communication and human development. If you've read Harari's book, Sapiens, he talks about the critical moment that us sapiens surged forwards. And that was on the back of what he calls constructive narrative. And what he says is that we suddenly developed the ability to tell stories. Now, why is that important? Chimpanzees talk. They talk. Oh, look, banana. Oh, that's great. Watch out, tiger. Boom, boom. But they don't create narrative. So what happens is they get to about 50 as a group, and then it all gets too complicated. I can't keep all these people together. And they split off. Because we developed narrative storytelling, we were able to create ways of grouping people together who'd actually never met, because I could pass that story on, you could pass that story on. So narrative storytelling became the absolute foundation of civilization. It became the foundation of communities, of villages, towns, cities. We created narrative to bind us together so we could grow and grow and grow. Without that, we would never have developed. And so narrative not only is critical to how we developed as sapiens, because that's what we are. We say Homo sapiens, but actually we're sapiens. And it is constantly fundamental to how we engage with the story. So it's so core to who we are. To kind of ignore it is to ignore a fundamental part of humanity. And you do it all the time. You know, I mean, I came in this morning and we were chatting and I said I was out last night at this amazing restaurant and da, 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 da. Then I had a conversation with, I was a bit late, and conversation with my son-in-law who said, so you're feeling a bit dusty. And you know, that's a lovely little story about, you know, I don't just walk in and say, I'm feeling dusty. And you say, what the hell's John on about? He's just feeling dusty. What the hell does that mean? I put it into a story and then you kind of remember it. So it's fundamental to not only us as human beings, but it's how we learn. From an early age, as a child, we tell stories. Once upon a time. The most famous line in storytelling, a line everybody knows. And everybody sits up. Once upon a time. And we go, oh, I'm going to learn, oh, it's going to be engaged, or I'm going to be find out something, or it's going to be funny or wonderful, whatever it is. So storytelling is actually crucial to not only our development, but our actual existence. So when you have people saying, well, you don't really need it anymore, you kind of go, what are you talking about? It's like you don't need to breathe anymore, or you don't need food anymore, or please stop that.
John, I can't help but think when we find ourselves in this present situation, February 2024, the way in which we're treating animals, the way in which we treat our air, land and sea, the increase of violence. I mean, what role can narrative, constructive narrative play in terms of hopefully saving humanity?
Well, I think, you know, technology is a friend and a foe, like so many things in life. You know, it's a friend and a foe. It is crucial to creativity, because without it, all we could do is tell each other a story or sing a song. But, you know, the development of the lute or the guitar or the piano was a major piece of technology that allowed us to expand that. So that's a very simple example. So technology is absolutely fantastic. However, there's also a dark side to technology. And I think what's happened over the last 25 years is that technology has encouraged us to kind of just kind of come within ourselves. We don't need to kind of be outside with everybody else. We don't need to kind of communicate with a huge number of people. We can do it one-to-one. And it's encouraged us to be insular. And I think encouraging us to be, that's the dark side of it. There are many positive sides to it. I'm not anti it, don't get me wrong. But that's the dark side of it. And it's encouraged an insularity that therefore allows other things to grow and develop without us really challenging it, because we're living in our little own little world. We don't engage with the world outside. It's encouraged us to live in little, you know, pods of thinking. You know, so it encourages us to be with other people who are like us, rather than challenging us to go out and engage with somebody who doesn't necessarily believe in what we believed in. So, you know, I think that is possibly one of the reasons why we are in this situation, that people, you know, exist within these little groups of people who think like them. And if you kind of doubt climate change, then you kind of do the algorithms within kind of the technology within social media encourage you to go to other people who doubt it. So your doubt grows and you ignore it and you don't engage with it, and it's all nonsense and I don't need to be part of it, and you know, whatever it might be. So it's driving people to insular thinking. And I think one of the great things about creativity is curiosity. Curiosity is fundamentally important to creativity. To go out and engage with things. Why is that like that? Why do we do that? And that curiosity, I think, is being the dark side of technology has been taken away from us. And that is a major, major concern, because I've got to listen to another point of view. I can then challenge it, and that other point of view has got to listen to me. But I think we've become so entrenched in our beliefs that we've now set up walls against other groups. And I think that's where this kind of allows the rise of, you know, how can I call it? Well, I call it isolated thinking occurs, and people will not engage with the subject. So it allows those other people putting forward these terrible views to grow and grow and grow. And that's where we are. And somehow we've got to break free of it.
Yeah. I mean, out of interest, in terms of being concerned about humanity's survival throughout your life, do you think this is one of the darkest periods you'd lived through right now, or have there been more difficult times?
I think I grew up with, nuclear, the bomb, and it could all be over in 4 minutes, the 4 minute warning. So I kind of look at it and I go, well, I grew up with kind of, the Cold War, and, at any moment somebody could press the wrong button, it could be, nuclear Armageddon. So, but what is so sad and in some ways depressing, that with all the knowledge that we have today, we find ourselves in this situation. That, I think, is the thing that I find most depressing. That with all the kind of, communication, all the kind of opportunity to explore, to understand, to kind of, we find ourselves once again in a precarious place. And that for me is the thing which I do get concerned about. I'm cursed as an optimist. So you've got to balance everything out with that. But it does concern me when I hear people talk about, the possibility of using nuclear weapons to solve a problem, constant conflict to solve problems, the imposition of one state on another state to impose their views. I thought we were getting beyond that, but we've regressed. And I think, but we've got to stay positive. We've got to show that if you are a concerned, involved human being who looks at all the aspects of every story and comes to a reasonable conclusion, you've got to believe that will win through. You've got to believe that eventually will. It's like the whole thing, the truth will out. And so I'm a great believer in that. obviously, you know, the huge damage we can go through if we don't rapidly get to that point of view is a thing that is very, very concerning, with war and climate change and social injustice and, you know, all the issues that we're facing. But I sort of, as I say, cursed as an optimist. Or Archbishop Tutu described it as, I'm a prisoner of optimism, which I thought was a lovely way of phrasing it. So, but I am very concerned. It's kind of weird that we should be having these conversations about those issues. I mean, you think, what?
Yeah.
You know, why are we talking about that? Yeah. And it's because I think social media, with its algorithms, has pushed us apart, as opposed to coming together. And of course, the power of great storytelling is, and the power of advertising is to bring people together, is to embrace, is to, you know, I'm not saying advertising is the solution to this, but you learn through advertising that your job is to kind of find a way of bringing us all together.
Yeah.
And that's, it's great skill, whether you like it or not, that's what it can do, and it does best when it's at its best.
Well, let's talk about that for a second, because you know that, you know, obviously, you know, we've been on the road, Peace Monday has been on the road 24 years now, using the camera from day one, of course, to point it in the right direction, to ask what we believed was a truthful question, and hopefully that would then yield the results that it did by creating a day of peace and the Afghanistan story of ceasefire and now 3 billion. But some interesting facts, you know, for you to know, John, was that we saw 23 billion movements in 24 hours of the words peace day, which was obviously incredible, and that was last year. And then we see that the Institute for Economics and Peace has said that compared to other days, they were seeing a 15% decrease in violent deaths on the day, which of course, is after all of this time of us working together on all of this, is obviously thrilling to know that the impact is at that level. So on that basis, given that storytelling was fundamental to the reasons why those numbers are there, what would you say to the storytellers, the influencers? Could they play a role in the institutionalization of the day? But most importantly, to the point that you were just saying a moment ago, could they turn this around and help become part of the kind of world that we want to live in?
Without question, I'm obviously going to say that. But what they've got to understand is you start with a brilliant idea. Peace one day. You know, I mean, it's hardly kind of something that you go, what's that? Explain it to me. What a powerful idea. And then from that powerful idea, create a story around it that brings it to life. Because it's no good just saying we all want peace one day, because we all go, yeah. But you've got to bring it to life to me in some shape or form. You might go, well, that's ridiculous, because we should be naturally responding to that. But because of the world we live in, where your attention is diverted constantly from one thing to another thing, and you're flipping, and you're doing this, and swiping left, swiping right, I don't know what way you swipe, whatever way you want to swipe, that kind of having a story behind that idea or wrapped around that idea, bringing it to life, will actually change people's point of view. Now, as an example of that, which is, you know, for those who aren't in the UK, we've had a major, major drama, an appalling situation about postmasters. And these are the people who run little post offices in communities, and they're part of communities. They instituted a new system of accounting, the company was Fujitsu who did it, and it was proving that it was failing to recognize that these people were actually recording the right amounts of money. And so it accused them of misreporting their earnings, and they were stealing money from the post office. This scandal, it was a failure of the technology, dark side of technology, a failure of the technology. Now, it's been going on for 20 years. First came to light in, actually longer, 1998. Various people recorded it. It wasn't until there was a dramatization of this issue on independent television, ITV, called Mr. Bates versus the Post Office, that the nation suddenly woke up to it. This is absolutely disgraceful that these people, these pillars of the community, have been accused of stealing money from the post office because there was a technological blip. It wasn't them doing it. They were having to replace the money. They were selling their homes. They were having their lives destroyed. Some of them committed suicide. All of that was there. It wasn't until there was this program on ITV, a dramatization called Mr. Bates and this guy who fought it versus the post office. The power of storytelling. Suddenly, the whole nation is talking about this. Now, if you're not in the UK, you won't understand it, but you can go online and look it up. It's absolutely amazing. So it's a perfect example of great storytelling. And at the core of it is obviously justice, which we feel very powerfully about. At the core of peace one day is obviously peace, one of the most powerful things in the world. So, but what we want, and this is the sort of odd thing really, what we want are people to tell amazing stories about peace one day in their own way, in their own kind of, and some of those stories will really ignite the issue. So it's the responsibility of all of us in the creative industries to take that on and find a way of explaining that and talking about it, not just saying, it's a date in September, we should all be doing it, and da, 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 because it is so fundamental to our future. And I do believe that it's through creativity that we will solve the world's problems. Technology is an enabler, but it's through creativity and through storytelling and through capturing people's imagination that we will actually solve that. Now, I will give you my little, I have a kind of, when judging an idea, I know you've got your wonderful three, it's inform,
inspire,
engage, which I think is absolutely terrific. And we were having a conversation and typically I said, I'd do it the other way around. I'd do it, engage to start with. And I'll explain why I do that, because I have a kind of a pyramid of kind of needs. And I always think the power of three. Good enough for God, if you believe in God. Good enough for us. And this is how I always judge an idea. And I advise people when they're looking at an idea, this is how you do it. So at the top is memorable, right? Top of the triangle, memorable. Because if it's not memorable, go home now. Just go home, pack up, go and have a cup of coffee, have a drink, whatever it is. You've failed. Because you haven't stopped somebody, what's the point? At the other, down here at the triangle, is it motivating? Because if it isn't motivating, I've stopped you, fundamentally important, and a world of competing ideas, I've stopped you, that's fantastic. But have I stopped you with a motivating idea? Is it going to make you go, wow, I didn't know that, I'm going to change my point of view, I'm going to think about that, or whatever it is. And at the other end, the other point of the triangle, is it truthful? Because I am trying to have a long-term conversation with you. And I don't have long-term conversations with people who don't tell the truth. So the truth is fundamental to communication. Fundamental. It's fundamental to creativity, actually. And I'll explain why in a minute. So that's how I do it. And that's what I want people to do with this piece one day. An idea that is memorable, which is, wow. Is it motivating? Piece one day should be. And obviously, have you founded it in truth in some shape or form? When you do those three things, you get communication that really, really moves mountains. And as I always say, and going right back to my kind of days of studying graphic design, you know, nobody ever marched to go, you know, I want the world to have Caslon bold, extra condensed, you know, with certain spacing. They marched for peace, or they marched for freedom, or they marched for justice. Big ideas. That's what changes the world, ideas. The means by which you communicate that die can involve Caslon extra bold or whatever it might be, can involve blue as opposed to red or whatever it might be, but it's big ideas that change the world. And so understanding ideas, understanding how they actually motivate, how they actually are created and how they can be judged is fundamentally important.
John,
John, I have to ask you, of all of the campaigns, of all the creativity, of all the stories that you've told throughout your life, what would be your number one, most memorable, that you're in many ways most proud of?
You know, it's a great question, that, and it's like, it depends on what, when you wake up in the morning, what do you feel like, and what is it kind of, and I was lucky to be involved in many great campaigns, but I suppose the one that I get marked for most is Levi's, the launch of the 501 campaign here in Europe in now 1985. Oh my God, I just see 1985. That's another one from the last century, isn't it? But I think what was great about it is that it demonstrated the power of storytelling. It demonstrated the power of communication. It demonstrated how talking to a mass audience, because the problem with digital social media, I should say, because everything's digital now, is it talks to a narrow audience rather than a broad audience. And you need to talk to a broad audience. Even if somebody doesn't buy your product, it's important that they know about it. There's a lovely line that says, a brand is made not just by the people who buy it, but also by the people who know about it. That is fundamental to brand fame. Because if you have brand fame, it kind of increases the value of what you're selling, it resists competitive pressure, it allows premium pricing, all of those wonderful things. So brand fame is fundamentally important. A simple example for you, I am sure you and I are never ever going to buy a Rolls Royce. I'm sure, I would put money on that. However, we completely understand what it stands for. So there is a brand, Rolls Royce, that's made by people knowing about it. So when you see somebody driving it, you go, ooh, that's the most luxurious car in the world. Ooh, dear me, that's, you know, you might be impressed, but you know, that's what you're feeling. So you know about it. So the idea of broadcast is fundamentally important. So the reason the 501 campaign, which we launched in 85, really was significant, because it changed the fortunes of Levi's. They were selling a 501 product that actually kids at that time, I use that phrase, it sounds condescending, doesn't it? But our target audience of sort of 16 to 20, the idea of Buttonfly was like, well, why would you want Buttonfly? Zip's much better, you know, and it was the wrong silhouette, which they talk about in fashion. However, we couldn't change the 501, that was it. But we managed to create a story around that product, use of music, that captured people's imagination. Now, the thing that made it was not only hugely successful for Levi's, they had to pull the advertising after 2 weeks because they couldn't keep up with demand, but it introduced the world to boxer shorts, and there's a story around that. I'll go into it and I'll tell you. When you get a script on television, it has to go through an approval process. You know, you can't just say anything you like or do anything you like. It has to be approved. When we submitted the script, we had this guy goes into a laundrette, takes his strips down to his underwear, puts it all into the washing machine, sits down to a big man on the bench. Now, we had him in his Y-fronts. The script came back and they said, very sorry, that's indecent. You can't have a man taking his clothes off like that. It's indecent in a public place. And we said, but it's a pair of Y-fronts, you know, it's just like, you know, Speedos, swimming trunks. And they said, nope, very sorry. We were backwards and forward arguing, and they came back and they said, well, if you put him into boxer shorts, that would be okay, because they're like shorts. And we went, boxer shorts? That was that dodgy American underwear from the 40s. And we went, okay, well, if that's going to get the script through, we will. We'll put him in there. So we put him into boxer shorts. Commercial runs. The sale of boxer shorts goes through the roof, you know. And I always say, Calvin Klein has never thanked me once, never even sent me a sort of like pristine pair of boxer shorts to say, well done, thank you very much. So it revolutionized that. Jeans, it revolutionized the way fashion occurred because of the 501 and the way you now wore clothes. And then it reintroduced great music from the sort of 50s and 60s, you know, heard it through the grapevine. And so it had this kind of profound effect on culture. And I think whatever you're doing, if you're an artist, if you're a painter, if you're a film director, if you're an author, you're not just trying to paint a picture, write a book, make a film. You're trying to affect culture. You're trying to be a part of culture. That's what makes a great piece of communication. And that's what it did. So I suppose, long story, sorry about that, but that was the work. And it then went on for about another 20 years, creating great ads that people talked about. You know, we had Brad Pitt in his, you know, before he became famous. We had directors who, Jonathan Glazer, who's just now done a brilliant movie. Do go and see it, Zone of Interest. It's absolutely fantastic, harrowing. Lesson to be learned there for everybody. And so we were able to work with Michel Gondry, and we did great, great work developing not only great stories, but working with great directors, Tarsen. We went on to direct all kind of movies. So it was a fantastic campaign that touched many, many parts of culture.
Incredible, John. Absolutely incredible. Well, let's have a look at that commercial now. So look, I mean, frankly, at that point I started to wear 501s, and at that point I was wearing boxer shorts, and every single young person at that point would say exactly the same to you. John, it was absolutely mind-blowing what you did, absolutely mind-blowing.
So John, for those who want to find out more about your incredible journey, your work, where do they go to for more information?
Well, I've written two books. I'm an art director, actually, and for me, I spent my life taking words out. Quite why I'm now writing books. You know, I always remember when Thames and Hudson asked me to write my first book, and I said, "But oh, I don't know. I'm an art director. You know, I take words out, not put them in." And eventually, they convinced me of doing it. And I said, how many words do you think I've got to write? And they said, oh, about 60,000. I mean, 60,000? You must be joking. I mean, you know, I usually do about 12 and that's it. You know, a poster, no more than 5, you know. So I wrote a book called Hegarty on Advertising, talking about my career, how I started, how I got going, and all the things that have affected me. And within that, there are stories about how you create a campaign, how you're a creative director, how you live in a creative world. The other little book I've done is just Hegarty on Creativity. And it's a book about how you live a creative life. And from that, I've developed... And during COVID, I was constantly being asked... So those two books are out there, Hegarty on Advertising, Hegarty on Creativity. One says there are no rules. The other one says turning intelligence into magic, which is what advertising does, turns intelligence into magic. But once we were... During COVID, I was constantly being asked to give online talks to large organizations, large, huge companies would say, John, you know, whilst we're doing, would you talk about creativity to our marketing people, our brand people, or however it is, which I did. And I always walked away loving doing it, but saying, I'm really not doing this properly in the sense of it's too big a subject to cover off in 40 minutes and then with 20 minutes of questioning. So I came out of COVID and I said to my partners here at the garage, look, I really do think we should do something about this. And we developed 8 talks. It's called The Business of Creativity because we want businesses to understand that to succeed, they should be engaging with creativity constantly. It's not something, oh, I occasionally do and people are afraid of it. And, you know, I spent my career with people going to me, oh, John, you're creative, so you decide. I say, no, 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 no. We are all creative. That's what separates us from the animal kingdom. We're creative. We tell stories. That's creative, you know. It's just some of us earn our living by it. That's the difference, all right? So it's a course that, and I wanted it for business, because business, you know, here we are with all the technology and algorithms and data, and it's no longer just data, it's now big data. Oh, blimey, it's big data. But get them to understand, what do you do with all this stuff? And because everybody's going to have the same stuff. They're all going to have the same data. They're all going to have the same algorithms. They can work through it. What's going to be the difference is how you imagine your service, your product, your business to be different in some shape or form. That's about creativity. So we've called it the business of creativity. And it takes people through a kind of, it's 8 lectures, it's online. And at the end of each one, I interview somebody from the business world who's been hugely successful. So like Greg Hoffman, who is the ex-CMO of Nike, talking about how they use creativity. Paul Smith talking about, obviously, in kind of fashion world, how you constantly engage with it. Thomas Heatherwick, brilliant, you know, designer, architect, talking about he runs a creative company and how they judge creative work and how they use it. So lots of fascinating people talking about it. So it's 8 lectures. And just to finish with this, just as we were developing this, McKinsey come out with this report, you know, consultancy company, very dry, very analytical, saying we've looked at this and those companies that engage with creativity create better returns for their shareholders. So I had a belief on my part about creativity and about imagination and how you vision the future. And then McKinsey saying, you guys, you know, businesses, you've got to engage with creativity. So it was a perfect moment, and we've released it, and it's wonderful, and it's good. We're getting great reports on it. And my passion really is for people to engage with creativity, because it's not just about business. It's not just about, you know, how you run something better or how you do something. It's about how you get more out of life. So in a way, it's kind of like a therapy as well as a kind of tool. You know, just the way some people kind of engage with yoga or something, which is wonderful. But actually, if you understand creativity and you understand your creativity, you get so much more out of everything in life. And that's what's lovely about it.
Amazing, John. Well, listen, thank you for today. You've been a great friend and supporter to me in Peace One Day. Thanks, John.
Congratulations to you and everything you do. And I do want people to engage with Peace One Day and show how they can help move this forward. And it saves lives. What a brilliant thing to do. Most precious thing in the world. Thanks. And well done you, Jeremy. Thank you very much.